Franco. So I'm delighted to introduce Professor Franco Sassi. He's an expert in the economics analysis of public health policies. His work has focused in recent years on chronic disease and the social and behavioral determinants. His work includes obesity, nutrition, physical activity, alcohol, and tobacco use. He has made numerous contributions to the research, including two books, The Economics of Prevention and Obesity, and another book on the economics of alcohol use and public health policy. Franco only joined Imperial in 2016 and has a chair in international health policy and economics. He's a director of our new center in health economics and policy innovation. Franco is also a senior health economics at the OECD in Paris, where he has established the OECD public health program. Thank you. Thank you, Franco, for being here.
Thank you, Laura. Thank you very much. That's a very kind introduction, but this session is not really about me or my work. We have two business leaders, Wendy Belluomini and Frank Lehmann, who I invite to join me on the stage. The session is about them, what they've been doing, and about their organizations, which are two key actors in their respective sectors. I'm talking about IBM and Nestlé, clearly IBM in this field of IT solutions and Nestlé in the field of nutrition and food. We are going to talk about how they've been driving innovation in the healthcare sector, which is something that clearly fits in very well with the discussion that we had so far during the conference. We have heard about the major challenges that healthcare systems are facing. We heard about aging, we've heard about lifestyles, we've heard about the potential shocks that might threaten the system, like antimicrobial resistance. We know now that innovation is lagging in the healthcare sector, and we don't have enough innovation, and often when we have innovation, it's not of the right kind. So there is a desperate need for disruptive innovation, and actors like IBM and Nestlé have been playing that role in the past few years and have the potential to change the landscape of healthcare innovation in the future. So let me start with Wendy. Wendy Belluomini is based in Ireland. She's the director of IBM Research Ireland. She has been leading the efforts of IBM in cognitive healthcare management. I hope she will explain what it means exactly during the talk, and health data privacy. And she's also the person behind IBM's strategy for brain-inspired computing, which is also something that we might need some explanation
okay.
about. So over to you, Wendy.
Okay.
I mean, as IBM entered the healthcare field, and what kind of innovation have you been producing?
Okay, let me start with the story of how we ended up in the healthcare business. IBM made a big impression on the world, I think, in 2011 with the Watson game show win that we went out and said, okay, we can get a machine to answer questions in an open domain in a way that's competitive with the best humans that are able to do. That was 2011. And that was exciting, but that was certainly not a business. That was a very nice public relations awareness kind of thing. So once that happened and we felt, the company felt like it had this ability to learn from data at scale, answer questions in a complex open domain, in some sense there was a search for, okay, what should we go do with that? And there were many things that were talked about, but the company really settled on healthcare as the place where we were going to make the biggest investment in bringing AI technologies to the marketplace, and where we thought that there was the biggest transformational potential, because the data was complex, there was a lot of it. People had kind of, we weren't the only people in that space, obviously, but we had not seen that transformation in that space that we thought was possible with data and machine learning. So between 2011 and 2014, when the Watson Health unit began, so we've only really been in this business for about 3 years. We went from almost nothing in a business sense. I come from IBM Research, so one of the things that we were able to do is leverage bits of science that we had in IBM Research. So interestingly, IBM Research will do work in areas that we're not in that business. We recently launched a product through Watson Health around a radiology assistant. So this is something that uses machine learning based on large amounts of data to identify stenosis in heart disease while also utilizing other things like medical notes, you know, background about the patient. The person who built that had been working at IBM Research on that problem for some 12, 15 years before IBM was in that business. Our genomics work is similar. So we have Watson for genomics. That's now a product. The scientist that built the underlying science for that product had been working on that in IBM Research for some 10 or 15 years. So one of the reasons why we were able to create this health business is that we, as a company, invest in science continually, even if we're not in that business. So IBM Research has some 3,000 scientists around the world that are building these seeds that might become IBM businesses later. So anyway, that was a bit of a digression, but we went from nothing in 2011 to the launch of IBM Watson Health in 2014. It's now 2017. We have some 7,000 people working in healthcare, some 300 million medical records, and 30 billion images that we have acquired through a set of acquisitions. In addition to then taking, we took that, and then we took the science that has been developed in IBM Research over the past 10 or 15 years, and now we have created what we think is a transformational capability around AI and machine learning plus large-scale data.
Who are your partners in this?
So for any of these things, we have to have partners. So for Watson for Oncology, for example, we trained that system with the doctors at Memorial Sloan Kettering in New York. We have work around predicting adverse drug interactions, predicting and tracking. When a drug is out in the marketplace, is it likely to have an adverse reaction with this patient? We're partnering with a company called Celgene in the US that does that. So we have a large consortium of around 24 providers and radiology groups around our radiology assistant that are bringing both data and expertise around how do you train these systems. So yeah, that's a key thing, that anything that IBM does in the health space is in partnership with clinicians and with other companies that have that deep, you know, 100-year history in many cases, developing and providing care in that space.
That's excellent. I mean, we come back to this because this conversation is really as much about what your companies are doing as how you're doing it and how you're achieving, you're pursuing leadership in innovation in healthcare. So that will be very interesting to find out more about. Frank. Frank is vice president of Nestlé, and he's head of open innovation and venturing at Nestlé. He wears different hats within the company, and one of the things he's been doing is leading the health innovation, the innovation acceleration team within Nestlé. Nestlé clearly comes into the healthcare field from a completely different perspective from IBM. Your background is food and nutrition. So what has driven Nestlé within the healthcare sector?
Okay, so thanks. Maybe let me put this also into perspective. I mean, we have heard a lot about what puts the pressure on the healthcare system overall. It's the demographics. It's in principle the aging aspect. I mean, we will see some numbers have been shared, but I saw another number, for example, that in the developed countries, around 2050, we will have 70% of the people will be above 50. Now, everybody who's above 50 can ask, are you already aging or not? So you may say you're still fit, but you feel already not like 20 anymore. So that's one thing. Then obesity is another topic. I mean, we have one out of three people are already either overweight or obese. 20% of the children in China start to have significantly weight issues. So that's, of course, is one thing. But subsequently, which was also said before, is the additional diseases which come with the whole thing, like diabetes type 2. So we've been, from a heritage point of view, over years, of course, of 150 years in the field of nutrition and health. So the thinking is, was always, and we saw this in the early 2000s and 90s, that we saw investments, we saw more and more technologies coming into the nutritional sector, where people started to try to, not to cure diseases, but to prevent specific actions through nutritional intervention. And I want to give one simple logic. I mean, we all know how much a diabetic patient type 2 will cost per year the healthcare system. Just assume you have somebody who is obese, who will not probably slim anymore, who comes into this. You can just prolong the fact that he moves into the insulin treatment by 1 or 2 years through a more adapted nutritional intervention. You save a lot of money for the healthcare system. So that was the starting point of our idea when we said, look, let's set up Nestlé Health Science in principle. What can we do through nutritional intervention? Not to cure, but to prevent diseases or to prevent metabolic disorders, to ensure we move forward. And you can take that when it comes to, I mean, technologies are developed and looked into this when it comes to cognitive decline, Alzheimer, with respect to ketone body diets, any kind of different technologies we looked at. We heard before, of course, the microbiome, which we don't understand at all, but we can start to modulate it and will have an impact on a lot of things of the lifestyle, mood, for mood, but also curing, how do you feel? And we see this, of course, when it comes to all kind of metabolic issues like diabetes. So that was the starting point. And we believe that that is one way forward, and you can, in principle, bring things into that right sector. I also want to say one more thing, and you see the people who are in the venture industry probably see this already, that nutrition is an emerging science. I mean, 10 years ago, we would have seen difficulties to have hardcore pharmaceutical approaches or biochemistries to work on nutritional topics. Today, we see more and more money flowing in. We see more and more investments into the nutritional space. So we see that there is a huge opportunity where new technologies will provide solutions in order, what I said before, to cure things. And we strongly believe it's not about, I mean, at the end, we all age. It's just to add good lives to your life, to just postpone also the issue. And also, when topics come up, like we hear a lot about fighting obesity, I think it's all more about preventing obesity or reducing the weight growth over time, because we should not be naive. At the end, I mean, the fact that this happens has to do with the lifestyle, has to do with the way of how we move forward. And that also is one of the ideas we believe. It's at the end, in order to do this from an initial nutritional point of view, it's just not a pure one single molecule solution. It's a combination of a nutritional intervention, a diet, maybe an advice, maybe a service. So at the end, it's a mindset change. It's a consumer behavior change. It's an individual consumer behavior change which we do. And that comes back why we believe as Nestlé we are very strong, because we are the brand owners. We are the first entry point to the consumer. I think we can, in principle, build that relationship with the consumer to build up.
You're raising an excellent point, among others, that innovation can actually help healthcare systems become more sustainable. And when I was saying in my introduction that we don't always have the right type of innovation in healthcare, I was meaning precisely that we've been great at producing innovation that has enhanced the capabilities of medicine and healthcare systems, and we've been much less good in terms of producing innovation that makes healthcare systems sustainable and increase productivity in the healthcare system. So what makes you confident, and that's really a question for both of you, what makes you confident that the type of innovation that you're working on will actually make healthcare systems more sustainable? Wendy, would you like to start?
I think the kinds of innovations that we're working on, when you really boil it down, are there to help make the individual people in the healthcare system more productive. So for example, with something like a radiology assistant, you're trying to make that radiologist find the image that she needs to look at in 2 minutes instead of in 10 minutes. From a healthcare sustainability point of view, that means that you don't need as many radiologists per patient. Because in the end, most of the costs in our healthcare systems come from how many people do we need to provide care at a certain level of quality. And so most of the innovations that we're working on, whether it's something like the radiology assistant or some of the things that we're building in Dublin around care management, which is a product where if you have a person who's in charge, like the health coach that was talked about earlier, who's basically in charge of managing a person's care, we're creating a set of tools to make that person more efficient, to learn from the previous patient that they talked to that looked like that and say, okay, you have a patient that looks like this profile. Here's the set of recommendations that you probably want to give to this person. Here's the set of services that you probably want to recommend for this person. And here's how that individual can access those services efficiently without that patient having to go do this planning task before they go and do the health task. Talking about compliance and getting people to take on healthy behaviors, it's hard enough to get people to take on healthy behaviors without having to add a planning task in front of it. So we're building systems that will do that planning task for you, who then work in concert with someone like a health coach that will have a personal relationship with the patient, so that the patient can then go take on those healthy behaviors with hopefully higher probability.
In behavioral economics, we call it commitment devices.
There you go, commitment devices, yeah. Yeah, I don't think it's quite that, because I have not seen a thing where it actually gives somebody that the hard incentive to do it. What we're trying to do, and maybe that's a good idea, but what we're trying to do is just kind of at least remove some of the barriers. Remove the, well, they told me to go take a exercise class, but the only one I know of is at a time that I can't really go, and so I won't do that. Instead, we know your schedule, there's an exercise class here, there's public transportation that will get you there at this time, and we have, provisionally signed you up.
I see an episode of Black Mirror.
Frank, do you have any further thoughts about sustainability?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we are in nutrition, we are selling food, so a bit of this simple thing, an apple a day keeps the doctor away. So if you're more healthy, you hopefully see the doctor a bit less, therefore you should have less pressure on the healthcare system. But make this a bit more serious. I mean, we are not only selling products in the developed world, we are selling a lot of products in the developing world where we fortify products with iron, with zinc, with vitamin A, where you have significant needs. And people in these salary classes who are in no healthcare system, and they buy our products because they cannot afford to be a day sick, because a day being sick means a day less of salary. So they need to stand. So they are looking for the right nutrition. Now, that is the developing countries. But I think we are moving into a similar concept in the developed countries as well, as the healthcare system may become more and more expensive. So there needs to be ensuring you live a more healthy life and you can be supported. That's, I think, our approach can be quite helpful. Now, having said that, of course, on one stage, there is a challenge when it comes to regulations. So how do the regulatory system we are today facing may not be suited if we long-term believe that nutrition can play a significant role to fight against the issues in the healthcare system. So also there needs to be adaptations. What are the claims you can do? What do you need to provide to do the claims? And I don't, I mean, this is not a secret, but of course, as a food company, you never have the same means to run the same trials as a pharma company. So you need to think through which are the areas where you allow a different approach or where you need to have a different approach of proving the efficacy of your nutritional intervention, for example.
To follow up on this, Frank, I've asked Wendy the question about partnerships. Clearly, following up on what you just said, Nestlé, as a major player, international player in the food sector, is under a lot of pressure from governments and public health agencies to work with them on addressing the issues to do with the obesity epidemic. So can you give us an example, one or more, of a constructive relationship that you have built with individual governments or public health agencies to address this problem?
I think we are working at the end. I mean, we've been several times under discussion about what are we doing and how should we move that forward. We are working more with respect, let's say, with public-private partnerships with the academics to find specific solutions, technologies in order to bring that forward. I think that is something definitely where we move forward. We have also worked, of course, with governmental institutions on several aspects when it comes to regulations, also when it comes, for example, to the WHO code, when it comes to infant formula feeding. So we are, in principle, working in partnerships in order to bring that forward. But I think the key part, because you asked about the partners, if you really want to innovate in that field, then you need to work with different sets of academics and industry partners in really to put forces together to find the next level of technologies. Because that is what it brings forward. As I said before, nutrition is an emerging technology. I think we cannot simplify the solution at one stage. I mean, also today when the food industry is under attack on governmental issues with respect to the obesity, one thing we should not forget, the food industry is a very diversified industry. So we are a large company, but we have a very small percentage of the market share. I mean, if you just need to go through London today and you think how much of your caloric intake is actually through packaged goods and how much you pick up in a prêt-à-manger or in an out-of-home food. So I think it's an overall solution as an industry body as well as a governmental intervention of where you bring these two elements together in order to find that solution. I mean, we are very open in order to bring better nutrition and more effective nutrition to the consumer, and knowing that our products have to require the necessary nutritional requirements.
Yeah, and, I mean, from what you say, I gauge that clearly there is still a barrier that needs to, you know, come down between government and business. I mean, you may, you know, still have a small share of the global market, food market, but you are a major player, and of course, you are in a position to set the standards in your sector. So clearly, there's a lot to gain from direct collaboration with governments. I think.
Yeah.
Let me just touch upon, before I open it up to questions from the floor, touch upon the global dimension of your work. We had previous conversations in which you explained that clearly IBM is a major international global player, has an interest in spreading the kind of innovation that you're working on to low-income countries as well. Can you perhaps comment a little bit on this?
So I think the kinds of cognitive technologies that Watson Health is building really have the opportunity to bring a level of quality of care into the developing world that may not be possible for many years otherwise. One of the things we discovered when we started working in assistance for oncologists that was when we had first built this system, and we took it to talk to, you know, our tier one teaching hospitals in the United States, the Stanfords, the Harvard Medical Schools of the world. They kind of looked at it and they said, "Yeah, we can do that. You know, we have the top tier oncologists in the world. They don't need help." And so then there was a bit of rethinking and said, "Okay, that makes sense. Where does the world need help?" So then we started thinking about, okay, we should go to places like India where we're starting to roll this out, where there's something like one oncologist for every 1,000 people, or it's not probably quite right, but something on that order, or in China where, you know, yes, humans can, and the top oncologists can do this just as good as any kind of AI-trained tool. But in many places, you're not going to have a top-tier oncologist that is available to most of the population. So can we give assistance to someone more on a general practitioner level that can provide almost top-tier oncology to someone who would have never gotten to see an oncologist before? And so we have work rolling out in India and in China in certain hospitals trying this out to bring kind of the level of care that people expect at a top-tier medical center to people that are at more of a regional level in the developing world.
Thank you, Wendy. Any thoughts from you, Frank, on this? On the way in which you can spread this, the innovation that you've been talking about to the developing world?
Well, I mean, in principle, we are selling, we are selling all over the place. So therefore, the innovation will flow dedicated to the different consumer needs. I mean, we are producing. I think we are in over 90 markets. We have over 450 factories. So that's not for us the issue to bring it at the end. I think that the question is more to get, depending on where you are, to have, for, let's say, more an affordable approach, of course, for the developing world than you have it in the developed world, because you, of course, need to live with the economic situation in the different countries. But you also see, I mean, that when we speak about the developing world, I mean, even if you take India and China and you look at the middle class, how big these classes are compared, and we have already tremendously huge markets. No, I think we've been in these countries already for a long time, and we will continue off on the franchise of what we are doing there to bring these nutritional interventions to the consumers.
Yeah. Thank you. So shall we open it up for questions from the audience? We have Ian Smith. Yeah.
Thank you very much for the. Can you hear me?
Yes, yeah. If you can introduce yourself.
Really, really interesting.
Would you mind introducing yourself?
Yes. So my name is Francesca Rumpulotta. I'm here as an executive MBA, but in real life I work for Imperial College and I deal with obesity. Actually, Imperial College as a center of excellence at St. Mary Hospital. So I was curious because lots of these examples that have been brought into the panel come from the United States, where we have essentially private healthcare. And so you don't deal with lots of the challenges of combining private and public healthcare. So we struggle sometimes in bringing prevention and treatment of obesity as a priority. And this means that we struggle to have beds for operating on this patient compared to oncology patients. We struggle to prescribe medication. For instance, we are now having problem in prescribing vitamin D, for instance, which is commonly low in this kind of patients. How can we address, do you see space for integration between private and public, and how can we improve prevention against treatment of disease when it's too late?
Probably a question for Frank, maybe?
Yeah, I think, of course, depending where you are, I mean, fortification of food is one of an easy way to improve the health status along the lines. I mean, I'm not aware of the subscription issue with vitamin D, but of course you have to, you can think through how you fortify in specific elements these things. I think also, and that was my comment on the regulation point of view, of course, nutrition at the moment, nutritional intervention is still coming up. So we are not yet there that, for example, you have a reimbursement model for nutritional intervention. The moment you would see this, maybe the reimbursement model would save a lot of money on the long term because you can bring this forward. I mean, that's in principle our vision, how some of these elements could work, and we could bring more of these emerging technologies on the nutritional side or the emerging science on the nutritional side to the consumers and to the patients. Yeah.
Smith, Four Seasons Healthcare. We talked in the last session about the system and you know, constraints to improving health outcomes, and we'll talk about it in the next session as well. But from your point of view, you know, it's clear that AI on the one hand and nutrition and consumer behavior on the other are very important. What do you find as the biggest frustrations as you try to take those to market? And you know, what would you do to, if you were in charge, to change the system so it was easier for us to take advantage of what you both do?
So start. I think for AI, the biggest barrier to adoption is data. Right. In order for AI to function at all, you have to have fairly large training sets, and those training sets need to be representative of the population that you're planning to treat. IBM made a number of acquisitions partly to develop our own data sets, but that's not enough, just what we have. And so I think coming up with mechanisms that both allow everyone to get the appropriate value out of their data, that protect people's privacy, because as, at least for the population that's currently mostly under treatment, people do really care about that. But yet allow the researchers and the developers to have access to good representative training sets for building the AI that they're trying to build is probably the biggest barrier, and that's a lot of working through legal contracts and usage rights and all of these things, which is not technical, you know, in the computer science sense at all, right? But we have to get that right if we're going to really see the potential.
I think what we see is more an opportunity than a frustration. I think with the fact that you move into electronic data, patient files, you're starting to collect more and more samples. For example, here in the UK, that big data element will allow us to find more or better nutritional interventions. So that's for us is definitely a big opportunity. Of course, I mean, changing consumer behavior, that's when you're a marketing company, you know that. I mean, working against a trend is extremely complicated and it costs you a lot of money. So I think you need to, in principle, understand the trend. And I think here with big data, with the collection, with also what IBM is doing and providing on tools and systems, that becomes extremely interesting in order to bring this forward. I think the as I said before, it's probably the thing where we feel things have to do is that nutrition needs to be, or nutritional intervention needs to have a better regulatory body. I think when you look at the regulatory regime which you have today, you can either go through the food regulation, you go through the pharma regulation when it comes, and then you can may have medical food for medical purposes. But that is, I don't think, sufficient enough if you really want to change in the future something.
Thank you. James, do we have a microphone here?
So, Wendy, this is really a question for you, and it's about some of the work that we've been involved with at WHO in looking at the future of healthcare in terms of the future of the health worker. And this is also, I think, related to what Professor Nicholas, you know, the health worker, our token clinician here, the little grenade he threw this morning about, you know, the 80% of the delivery, the service delivery, versus the 20% that is really what you could call a pure technology innovation. So the way we've been thinking about it, and I want you to challenge this if you think I've got it wrong.
Okay.
The way we've been thinking about this is that the health worker is not going to be replaced by a machine, but the machine will be like a multiplier, force multiplier for the health worker.
No, that's exactly our strategy, right? I think the health worker is not going to be replaced by a machine, but that same health worker is going to have to treat two or three times the patients that they treat now with our aging population. And as middle classes want access to high quality care in developing countries, you know, there's not going to be enough health workers to have the same kind of ratios as we do before. So we don't expect to be able to replace health workers. We do expect to be able to make them both more effective, hopefully, and more productive.
Yeah. Maybe just to build on that, I think with AI and with analytics, we will not need as many health workers. In fact, we'll need different kinds of health workers. Mm. Actually, that's very important. Mm. And this is something that we've not got right. Mm. Mm. In many countries, unfortunately, laws governing health professionals go back to 1940s, 1930s, 1920s. It's very difficult to change their roles and responsibilities. Mm. It requires not just a change in directive within a health ministry, it changes legal change in the law in relation to the public sector as a whole. So very difficult to achieve, especially in countries that have sort of bicameral systems. But my comment was in relation to data. It's quite late in the day, so let me tell you a real story to make you laugh, I hope. I know telling jokes is very risky. So this is a country where, which will remain nameless, where they introduced a big data system. The whole country was covered with electronic health records. But when everybody logged on, what happened, do you think? System crashed. So what they did, so health workers were using paper to take notes. Then in the evening, somebody would enter the data into the system. So I don't think data is the problem, actually. There are many data around. The problem is analytics, getting the right information, right intelligence to the right people at the right time. If we can get that right, and I think we can really transform this, I think what Nick Peters talked about, this pathway, managing the care process, because there's so much inefficiency in the steps that we take from getting A to get from A to B, we go to A to Z, then work backwards.
Well, it's getting the data to the analytics, right? It's getting the data to the analytics. There's lots of data in EMRs all over the place, right? But it's getting that data, you know, fed into the analytics to then produce an insight that's missing. And I'll tell a story as well. So I went to the doctor, and my doctor said, and I said, she asked what I did, and I said, I work for IBM. I hate IT companies, she said, because she used to be able to go out with her friends on Thursday nights, but now because of the requirement to put everything into EMR, she spends her Thursday night and Friday night sitting there copying her notes into EMRs. So this is the, you know, not taking into account the workflow, right? We've gone and we've kind of added another task to a provider that didn't have any time.
The same company.
I think we have time for those two questions before we close.
So Nick Peters. That was an interesting little story. Did you say she hates your company?
Not my company in particular, just IT companies and computers in general.
Okay, so just to be a little bit provocative, it sounds to me like IBM is a big company that is throwing lots of money at a solution that's going to be looking for a problem. To what extent have you looked at the problems that need addressing and are tailoring the solutions to the articulated problems?
So it depends on the thing. So we don't have one solution. We have a number of different solutions. I think in the care management space, which is what the Ireland team is working on, we work very directly with care management companies that are coming to us with, this is a problem. And so I think that we are solving a problem that people care about because our customers tell us that we are.
Well, care management is already 3-4 tiers away from the coal face.
From the what?
From the coal face.
The clinical.
Oh,
the clinical coal face. And the story you told was from somebody at the coal face.
Yeah.
Which is driving her crazy.
Yeah. So can I say that we're addressing this perfectly and we're working directly at the coalface in every instance? Not necessarily. But I don't think any company is.
Well, I don't think care management companies are exactly at the coalface.
No.
I mean, patients and deliverers of care, care workers, I think is Jeremy's phrase.
Right, so I'll talk about a different thing. So like I said, there's a lot of different things. One of the things that we have put together is around, in talking about type 2 diabetes, is about around the ability to predict when someone is going to have a hypoglycemic event 2 to 3 hours ahead of when that's going to happen. So in that case, I think that's a real problem. Patients say this is a real problem. And so what we provide is actually an app directly to the patient who is trying to deal with this issue that they can use that will tell them, you know, based on your history of what you've been eating and what, you know, what you've measured, you're very likely to have a hypoglycemic event. This is what you need to go do. I think something like that is much closer to the coal face than care management.
Just one last question.
Sarah Haywood from MedCity. I wondered whether both of you could say a little bit about how you work with SMEs, if indeed you do, and Frank, specifically, the extent to which you Nestlé is moving away from its traditional approach in terms of foods and looking at other products that sit alongside your traditional market, perhaps digital technologies.
So we have, in principle, we have different approaches to tackle the open innovation space, especially when it comes to SME. So either we take minority stakes or we acquire these. But for us, which is a much more important way, is actually a licensing deal. So we have quite a lot of small, very unique companies with a specific technology who develop for us in a specific segment a specific new product or service, which we then can use for a period of time exclusive, and then we do this. So we are extremely relying on these, also on the small startup scene, on the SMEs, who bring the more innovative technologies. Now, what is the challenge for any SME to come into a large, huge corporate, and that's probably not Nestlé specific, is in order to have a business which is then relevant for us, you need to have a specific size. So take this, you want to jump on a running, on an outgoing train, you rather speed up, so else you miss the train. So that's the thing. So what we are looking for is really nurturing this in one of the venture funds to a size, so then the company can be easily taken up and is equivalent to what our internal business activities have. There's nothing worse than having a very small company with a very exciting future business plan still costing a lot, and a business manager who has to choose between his existing business, which he understands, and something we take in. So often we come relatively late then actually, let's say, capturing and taking most of the SMEs. But for SMEs, we have a lot of SMEs who are really service or solution providers along the lines, and especially when it comes to a space outside of the classical food, and that was the second part of your question, when it comes to digital health or whatever, of course, we capture very carefully what is happening, and we are very interested in what's happening and what could be relevant for our product solutions at the end.
Thank you. Wendy, would you like to comment briefly on the IBM's model of open innovation as well?
Yeah, so as I said, I think almost everything that we do in this space is with through partners or with partners in some way. I mean, from an SME perspective in particular, I mean, we partner with a number of, I would say, medium enterprises who are care groups, hospital groups, doctor groups. This is, you know, covering maybe a sub-region of a state to come in and bring one of the Watson Health technologies to them. And you know, as we're developing new technologies, these are usually in partnership with either a large pharma company, a large hospital group, these kinds of things, to bring that clinical knowledge together with the AI knowledge that we have to build something.
Thank you. So I would like to thank Frank and Wendy for a great session. Clearly we have learned that there is a huge potential for innovation from actors that are not traditionally part of the healthcare sector, but clearly there are also major barriers that need to be overcome for this innovation to really make a difference in healthcare. And we've learned that it's not technical barriers, it's more legal, bureaucratic, and possibly political barriers, and that's everyone's business here to bring those barriers down. Thank you.
Thank you.